we were talking about, so when we reviewed last time, we had established all of the columns. So in terms of our review, you know, we had established, you know, Virginia, and we said that that was the first colony, and we established Plymouth and Massachusetts, eventually all of the New England colonies. Then we went back down and talked about Maryland briefly, and then we talked about the difference between royal colonies, proprietary colonies, joint stock companies. But one of the things that we did, and we didn't spend a lot of time in the establishment of those colonies, but one of the things that we highlighted was that these colonies were established in a haphazard, sort of disorganized manner without any real overall plan. And the result of that was that they were widely diverse. And we talked about some of the reasons for the diversity of the colonial possessions. We said that different people went there. We said that they had different relationships with Native Americans. We said that they had different climates and topographies. We said that there were different motives for settling the colonies in the first place. And all of these things result in kind of different colonial possessions, all being part of one British Empire. And so, you know, obviously where we want to move to is the American Revolution. But before we do, you know, we stressed a couple of kind of commonalities that colonial Americans had. And one was they were all part of the British Empire. And as such, they had a familiarity with the British system of law and the British system of government. We were not going to talk at length about that. But, you know, all of them had some level of representative government, even the ones that remained proprietary colonies. You know, they had all an association with common law. They had a heritage of kind of British culture and language, even though in some cases they were diverse, particularly the middle colonies. I mean, this is true. They also had kind of a connection, at least the intellectuals in those colonies had a connection to the Enlightenment. And we said the Enlightenment was this intellectual movement that you know, starts in Europe and spreads to America, that elevated reason over religion and emphasized science and human improvement. And the Enlightenment affected the way that people thought in colonial America. It was connected to kind of ideas of self-government, rights, and other things. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. And then when we concluded, we talked about religion. And one of the things we want to say about religion is that religion is important in colonial America everywhere. Now, it might be more important in New England, and maybe more important in some parts of the middle colonies to some, you know sects like the Quakers and others, but it's important everywhere. It's overwhelmingly Protestant, Christian. You know, most of the people there are Protestant Christian. But the sheer diversity of religious viewpoints throughout colonial America is going to result in kind of a burgeoning sort of religious toleration and religious freedom. You know, which would go to kind of something, you know, related to American identity. You know, one of the things that you might be asked about on the AP test are things about American identity. You know, and when you talk about identity, it's what makes you you, right? So then the question of American identity is what makes America America, right? And one of the things I think that you could put into that category is ideas of self-government, freedom, you know, things like that, make America America. But so does the idea of religious toleration and religious freedom. And where these things come from are important. Like the Religious Toleration Act of Maryland of 49, like the settlement of Rhode Island by Roger Williams, where they offered religious toleration, like North Carolina that offered some level of religious toleration. You know, all of those examples, like Pennsylvania that protected religious freedom, you know, and advertised that and attracted diverse, you know, Protestant sects from Europe that came there, the Pennsylvania Dutch and others like that, Amish and others like that. You know, that idea of religious freedom is, I think, important. The Great Awakening was important, too. We ended with the Great Awakening. We said that was a religious revival, right? You know, that was sparked by people who believed that the Enlightenment had influenced the way that people thought about the world too much. And that people had to get a more emotional understanding of their status, you know, their imminent doom because of their sinfulness, and the grace of God that would save them. And we said that people like, you know, George Whitefield are going to preach these demonstrative messages in a colonial-wide manner. And it gives people, on some level, a common connection with each other. Now, in terms of moving from those diverse colonial possessions that have some commonalities but are really living, you know, an existing parallel and, you know, to each other. I mean, it's more likely that New York had a closer relationship with England than it did with South Carolina, right? And these colonies are independent, but all part of the British Empire, right? But one of the things that's going to move in terms of unification are the four wars between England and her allies and France and her allies. And that starts in 1688. I can't imagine that there'll be much on the AP test about any of the wars for empire, except for the final and the fourth war. And that is the Seven Years' War, or in the United States, the French and Indian War. Now, frankly, in reviewing and talking about that war, we talked more about it and more about the details of that war than ordinarily you would get in an American history class anywhere else in the country, largely because, you know, a lot of that war happened in western Pennsylvania. It was the fourth and final war for empire. It was a battle for, you know, colonial empires between France and England. And ground zero for the fight was western Pennsylvania, right, the Ohio River Valley. That's where the first clashes of the war start. That's where George Washington makes his debut, as an officer in the British military, and really makes his debut in history. And, you know, again, I'm not sure. I think maybe one thing about the French and Indian War that might be relevant is the significance of the Iroquois Confederation in that war. You know, I mean, the Iroquois are going to be influential power brokers in that war. And the fact that the British want them as an ally and the French can't get them as an ally is significant there. You know, so I think the Iroquois and other Indian tribes that are involved, you know, might have some significance. But I think the biggest thing about the fourth and final war is that when it ends, that France is definitely defeated. And the first Treaty of Paris that ends the French and Indian War, the Seven Years' War, France surrenders its entire North American empire to the United States and Spain. Or not the United States, England and Spain. And remember, we talked about it, showed you a picture, you know, of, you know, the empire before and after. You know, that all of New France is surrendered to England. And I think more significantly than that is that the victory in what is the French and Indian War poses to England, you know, some substantial challenges. And those challenges we identified as three, right? That the British in the aftermath of the French and Indian War had now a huge empire, the greatest in their history, right, that they had to control and maintain and protect and oversee. You know, so protecting, maintaining, and overseeing this vast empire is going to be a challenge for England. Second thing that they had to do is they had to manage it for their benefit, which we put under the category of tightening mercantilism. If you're going to oversee this huge empire, you want it to benefit, you know, England, right? You want the British Empire to be prosperous and to benefit the mother country. That's the idea. And so part of what they had to do was tighten mercantilism. And then thirdly, we said their challenge was financial. That winning that war against France was extraordinarily costly, and that the debt of England was huge, and that financing that debt was enormous. Now, so England has some significant challenges. And I think what happens, and if we look back at it, we say, okay, America, the 13 American colonies are established by that time. They participate on some level in the Fourth War for Empire. People like Washington serve in the military, colonial militia. They are proud of their effort in that war. They celebrate with England in their victory. But in the aftermath of that victory, we know that between 1763 and 1776, England and their colonies are going to separate. That in 1776, 13 years after that, you know, the Declaration of Independence will be the formal division between, you know, the American colonies and England. And remember, we even read, you know, in the aftermath in 1763, remember how excited I was on this day when Ben Franklin, you know, we read Ben Franklin and he said, you know, unity amongst the colonies, you know, is not merely impossible or improbable, it's impossible, right? That Franklin thought the idea of the 13 colonies unifying to rebel against England was not merely improbable, it was impossible. And so then we pose the question, what leads these colonial possessions that are so widely different and have different economies and different relationships and different ethnicities and even different religions and different emphasis and all these differences, with some general commonalities, what leads them to rebel, right? And we actually wrote an essay about that. You know, we answered questions, we read things about that. You know, we read Degler and we read Zinn and we read, you know, Nash, and we had ideas about, you know, what caused those colonial possessions to rebel. You know, in terms of how we organized events, we said, look, right, the first kind of events that lead eventually to the revolution could fall under the category of the Stamp Act, right? You know, so really there are three phases to Britain's actions, right, and Americans' responses to those actions. The first would fall under the category of the Stamp Act. And those actions would have to do with Grenville's response to the big three challenges. The big three challenges that I mentioned were the challenge of, you know, maintaining the empire, you know, and controlling it, the challenge of tightening up mercantilism, and the challenge of paying for it all. So now consider this for a second. In terms of the Stamp Act, and that's in 1765, right, the Stamp Act. In terms of legislation or British actions, parliamentary actions, parliamentary legislation, royal actions, you know, what sort of things does Britain do specifically to accomplish their objectives that alienate Americans? Oh, is that a good question? Wow, is that a good question? So now let's think about it, Eric. Let's put in our minds. The end of the time frame where you can answer from is the Stamp Act. So this, I'll give you a hint. The Stamp Act was one of the things they did. But you can't say that. You got to say other things other than the Stamp Act that the British did to respond to their challenges. Miller has a thought. Let's see what it is.
The Sugar Act.
Ah, the Sugar Act is going to tighten up on mercantilism. Now, the Sugar Act is significant because not only does the Sugar Act, you know, revise the Molasses Act and attempt to tighten up the enforcement of collecting a tax, the Sugar Act specifically states that the purpose of the tax that was levied there was for the purpose of generating revenue, right? True. So the Sugar Act is Grenville, he's the Prime Minister, the Sugar Act is consistent with British objectives, tighten up mercantilism, raise money, that's what they're looking to do. But when they state in the preamble of the Sugar Act that the purpose of this action is to generate revenue for the crown, for the royal government, Americans are going to say, you can't do that. You can't do that. You cannot tax us for the purpose of generating revenue. Why not, BJ? You are a specialist in this topic. Why not? Why would the Americans say, you can't do that? No, this tax is a violation of our natural rights.
Because it was taxation without representation.
It was taxation without representation, and that's what they would argue. That was the slogan. Oh, by the way, who coined that term? Taxation without representation is tyranny. Do you know? Do you know? Do you know? No, that's a good guess. James Otis, right? It was James Otis that coined that. Taxation without representation is tyranny. But why is taxation without representation tyranny? If you were going to explain that to somebody, why the colonists who were part of the British Empire, who had benefited by the British Empire, right, who would agree to accept taxes for the purpose of regulating trade, argued if the purpose of the tax was to generate revenue, that it was a violation of their natural rights. Yes?
Because they didn't actually have any real people in Britain to voice their opinion, so the British people were kind of thinking what the Americans would, what the colonies across the sea would find best, but they didn't actually have a say.
Okay, so you are saying that Americans had no representation in Parliament. And Parliament was levying this tax for revenue for Parliament. And this was a violation of their natural rights. So let's take a step back. That's true. But let's take a step back. What was the notion of natural rights? Where did that come from? What was the notion? Go ahead, Liz. What was the notion of natural rights?
That was from the
preamble. No, that's common sense. But natural rights. Go ahead, Doug.
John Locke.
John Locke. And so Locke said that by virtue of being born, people had inherent natural rights. Life, liberty, and property. Okay, Benny, based on that, how did the idea of natural rights connect to government? So people had natural rights, and this connected to government. How so? Okay, government can't do anything to intrude on those rights, but the purpose of government was to do what? I mean, the purpose of government was to do what?
Make sure those rights aren't violated.
Right. To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. So if we go back to the Declaration of Independence, it says all men are created equal. All men are created equal. What was the next part? All men are created equal. I'm blanking. With certain inalienable rights, among these being life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men. So the purpose of government, I mean, think about it, right there. I mean, that's Lockean in the Declaration of Independence. That's Lockean in its nature, that all people have rights, right? And these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And the purpose of government is to secure these rights. Right? That's why governments are instituted among men. And really what Locke argued and what Americans bought into is that government was a contract, right? That people agreed to obey government in protection, in return for government protecting their rights. I mean, that was the contractual nature of government. Now, taxation without representation, Otis and others argued was theft. That the government was taking people's property without their consent because they did not have representation in Parliament. And the only people that could tax a landowner or a citizen was a body in which that landowner or citizen had representation. If they didn't have representation, it violated their right to property by stealing their money. So the Sugar Act is the first time that this argument is made against the British government. The Stamp Act, the argument is more, you know, more forceful. But besides the Sugar Act, right, what else does Britain do in that first kind of round of action in the aftermath? The Sugar Act is a big one. Do you remember anything else? They're going to do other things to try to accomplish their objectives. Yes? Downes's Acts are later. Downes and Acts are later. Yes, ma'am. Yes, the writs of assistance, right? And remember, it is Otis's, oh, remember that. Remember when we talked about the writs of assistance and John Adams said right there in that courtroom on that day, the child independence was born, right? In the argument that Otis made, he was a flame of fire according to John Adams, and he made that argument in opposition to the writs of assistance. And when he made that argument, he also based that argument on violation of natural rights. So colonial Americans, at least some colonial Americans, were seeing British actions increasingly as dangerous violations of their liberties, right, in their view. Now you could argue that maybe it wasn't that at all. Maybe it was just economic disruptions that Britain was doing. They didn't want to pay the taxes, and they came up with these reasons to sort of justify a more practical thing. Maybe, maybe not. But Vijay has a thought on it. Let's see what it is.
I was going to ask, what exactly were the writs of
assistance? The writs of assistance were global search warrants that the customs officials in Boston were going to...
Mr. Wallace, if you're still in the building, please call 20,001 or come to the main office. Mr. Wallace, if you're still in the building, please call...
I can't go down there.
I'll run down.
Run down there and tell them I'm busy. Yes, tell them I'll be down in 15 minutes or 20 minutes. These kids got to learn. But she has fleet of foot. Look how fast she is. Look how fast she is. Let's see what time it is. Let's see how long. I have 3 to 3. Do you think she'll be back with me?
Yes.
What were we talking about? The writs of assistance, yes. And you chose what you chose to text in the interim between the writs of assistance.
Which
your mother?
Yeah, she's saying if she needs me to come pick her
up. She said what?
She's saying if I need her to come pick me up.
Oh. What did you tell her?
I'm telling her yes.
Okay, good. Because otherwise you won't have a ride, huh?
Yeah, that's
right. You know, so that's a good thing to say. Yeah. So we're talking about the writs of assistance. That's good, Vijay. The writs of assistance is good. Writs of assistance with global search warrants, deeply resented by Boston merchants, right? You know, who argued, Otis argued, was a violation of their natural rights. There's one more other thing that I'd like to identify with this kind of first swing at things. Yes?
I just have a question. Mm-hmm. When did Britain formally take over all the colonies? Mm-hmm. Like, when did they all...
There are two colonies they never really take over, right? It's progressive. You know, they take over Virginia like in the 1640s, Massachusetts Bay in the 1680s, but Pennsylvania is a proprietary colony to the Revolution. So is Maryland. I don't know if Delaware was part of Pennsylvania. It might have been, right? You know, so these colonies, they never are fully taken over. And the other ones are you know, gradually, you know, at different times. They all are, I think, except for those two, they're all royal colonies by the time of the Revolution, where the governors are being appointed by the crown, right, you know. All right, so, but there's one other thing I'm looking for in that first kind of, you know, actions by Britain. We would call it the Stamp Act crisis, right? Yes. Well, no, the Navigation Acts are the 1660s, and the Navigation Acts are what you're going to enforce, yes. No, that's after. The Proclamation Line of 1660, that's what I was looking for. The Proclamation Line. I mean, all these things are going to happen. So, you know, I mean, the war ends and the Proclamation Line of 1663 is passed to prevent migration west. The Sugar Act is passed. The Currency Act is passed. But the real big, the writs of assistance are requested. And you know, cumulatively, these actions cause Americans to fear that their liberties are being jeopardized. And their pocketbooks are being influenced by this. I mean, look, if they tighten up on mercantilism, as they propose, the intent of mercantilism, as we talked about last week, was to enrich the mother country at the expense of the, you know, the colonies. So as long as there was salutary neglect, the colonists were kind of, you know, benefiting from the British Empire, but it really wasn't enforcing kind of that mercantilistic transfer of wealth. But now, with a bigger and, you know, empire and more stringent kind of enforcement, their prosperity was going to be jeopardized. So they're seeing their rights and their prosperity potentially jeopardized by these actions, right? And, you know, part of the question is, whoa, Well, you brought Mr. Williams down with you. Very nice, very nice. Can you give me a few, Mr. Williams?
I'll just observe and learn.
Okay. You made it back by 3 o'clock. We called.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I made it back.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyways, you know, back to their rights. These dual things are important, right? Would these actions jeopardize their liberties? And would these actions jeopardize their prosperity? And remember, part of what we did was kind of debate that. You know, that was part of the question that we debated. Okay. So that's the, let's talk about this. The big culmination of it was the Stamp Act. All right, so the Stamp Act is passed in 1765. And that's when your textbook says the colonies erupted in protest. So they didn't like the proclamation line of 63. They didn't like the Sugar Act. They didn't like the writs of assistance. They didn't like the Currency Act. They didn't like the Quartering Act. All these things passed in that first round. But really when they got mad is when the Stamp Act passed. Right? So the Stamp Act was the final blow. Their response to the Stamp Act was kind of in three parts, and we talked about that. And I think these are significant because they represent kind of the colonial resistance to British action. One part was that they had resolutions. You know, legislatures, you know, the colonial legislatures, you know, had resolutions opposing, you know, the Stamp Act and arguing it was a violation of their liberties. Patrick Henry was central to that in his argument, you know, in those, you know, powerful resolutions that were put forth in the Virginia House of Burgess. The Stamp Act Congress, you know, met for the first time. Why was that significant? We made a big deal about that. The Stamp Act Congress meets for the first time. They gather together to oppose, you know, the Stamp Act. And I said, that's a really, really, really big deal. Go ahead, BJ.
Was it because that was the first time all the colonies came together?
It's the first collective action. And remember, Megan, what Franklin said in 63. A unity amongst the colonies, an arrangement amongst the colonies, not merely improbable, it is impossible. But, and they could, remember this. Remember we talked about the Albany Congress in 54, when they met together in 54 for the purpose of unifying against the French and Indians, they couldn't do it. And then in 63, you know, Franklin says it's never going to happen. They're never going to unify. But then, in opposition to the Stamp Act, they unify the Stamp Act Congress. Then they agree to a colonial boycott, right? To boycott all the buying things from Britain, you know, a non-importation agreement that are enforced colonial wide that has a real devastating effect on British industry. And then they also agreed to enforce these things by vigilante organizations like the Sons of Liberty. And the Sons of Liberty are going to enforce that the non-importation and intimidate stamp collectors and others. And remember we talked about, you know, the destruction of Hutchinson's home, the mob that destroys Hutchinson's home and the violence there was in New England. What's the result of all of this? What happens to the Stamp Act? Do you remember? What happens? I mean, go ahead, Megan. It is repealed. No stamps are ever collected, right? The colonists celebrate the repeal of the Stamp Act, but Congress, or the Parliament, passes the Declaratory Act, or the Declaratory Act, you know, after the Stamp Act is repealed. Now, the Declaratory Act, or the Declaratory Act, is ignored by colonial Americans. They say, wow, we won, they repealed the Stamp Act, that's great. They ignore the Declaratory Act, but what the Declaratory Act basically said was that the repeal of the Stamp Act was not an admission that Parliament couldn't do what it was doing. Basically, the Declaratory Act said that Parliament could do whatever it wanted to do with the colonies whenever it wanted to do it. That it was supreme in all cases, and these were the words, in all cases whatsoever. That Parliament was supreme in all cases whatsoever. Now, the Declaratory Act will set the stage for the revolution. Because what colonial Americans are going to say is that Parliament is supreme in this area, but not this area. And what Parliament is going to say is, no, we are either supreme in everything or nothing. Right? We're either supreme in everything or nothing. And eventually, that will force colonial Americans to say nothing. Right? Now, at this point, when the Stamp Act is repealed and the Declaratory Act is passed, you know, everyone, I don't want to say everyone is happy, but colonial Americans are certainly happy, and they're not intending on revolting. Now, the second round of actions is called the Townsend Act crisis. So we have the Stamp Act crisis, and then the Townsend Act crisis. Right? And then the Tea Act crisis. So there are three escalations: Stamp Act, Townsend Act, Tea Act. Right? Three escalations. The Townsend Act is when Charles Townsend takes over, Prime Minister. He passes all of the import duties on products that are imported to America. But the Townsend duties specifically state that the purpose of these duties is to generate revenue for England, right? As such, they are opposed. Now, one of the guys that opposes the Townsend duties is a guy named John Dickinson. Now, I said this, I don't ever remember, it's a long time ago. We said that Dickinson wrote a series of pamphlets called Letters from a Farmer in PA. And his pamphlets were enormously influential, and Dickinson's opposition to the Townsend duties was significant. Does anybody remember why I argued that Dickinson's opposition to the Townsend duties? He was a prominent lawyer from Delaware, Pennsylvania. He's an important figure in the road to the revolution. Anybody remember why Dickinson was so important? We said, hey, these were a big deal, these letters from a farmer in PA. Anybody remember besides the instructor? John Dickinson. Tell me what you remember of John Dickinson. Go ahead, Cronka. Tell me what you remember of John Dickinson. You remember nothing. Go ahead.
He was like well respected, like people liked him.
Yes, he was well respected, people liked him. Go ahead. What's that?
He didn't support the Declaration of Independence.
He did not support the Declaration of Independence. He was very conservative, right? And so he represented the most conservative elements of colonial America, still opposing British actions. I mean, I think this is true. I think that, look, there is going to be eventually diversity in whether or not people think it's a good idea to seek independence. But everyone is against British actions. They're unified in that. And Dickinson's opposition is significant because he represents the ultra-conservative, you know, kind of wealthy Americans saying, we don't like this either, right? And then you had, on the other hand, the mobs that destroyed Hutchinson's house saying, we don't like it either. Right? So there is widespread opposition. Now, the Townsend duties relate, you know, eventually connect to the Boston Massacre. It is, you know, the customs officials that are brought in to collect the Townsend duties that need protection from British troops. And remember, we talked about the Boston Massacre. You'll never guess who was at the Boston Massacre, who was killed by the British. Crispus Attucks. Boy, do I hope there's a question about that on the AP test, Crispus Attucks, because everybody knows that, right? Crispus Attucks was there. And remember, one of the things we said about the Boston Massacre was, yes, these troops were brought here to enforce the Townsend duties, to protect them, and they had hostility to the Bostonians. But the people that were in that mob that night were not the best people in Boston. Right? They were not the best people in Boston. They were the underclass of Boston, who had this seething resentment with the soldiers because they fought over jobs and things like that. Right, now let's go quickly to the last thing, and that's the tea act. After the Boston Massacre, the Townsend duties are repealed except for the tax on tea, right? Except for the tax on tea. And there's a period of relative calm. Between 1770 and 1773, there's a period of relative calm in the colonies. And no one is thinking about independence. You know, Sam Adams and John Hancock are trying to keep people vigilant to British, you know, but people don't want to be independent. They want Britain to respect their rights, but they want to be part of the British Empire. What most people wanted was to go back to the way things were prior to 1763. And in between 1770 And 1773, it looked like that was true. Americans circumvented the tax on tea by smuggling in Dutch tea, right? The whole thing explodes when Parliament passes the Tea Act, right? Now, does anybody, Parnev, do you remember what the stipulation of the Tea Act was? What was the Tea Act intended to do?
It was intended to make sure that the British East India Company didn't go bankrupt.
What did he say? What did he, yes, go say it again.
It's intended so the British East India Company doesn't go bankrupt.
Yes, it was intended to protect the British East India Company to give them an exclusive monopoly on tea. Oh, what country, modern day country, did the British East India Company oversee?
The homeland.
Sir, that was a great day, wasn't it, BJ? The homeland, yes, India. Yes, so in order to keep that colony afloat, right, they wanted to pass that legislation. Now remember this, we said it was win-win-win. The British thought, well, we're going to save the British East India Company, give them an exclusive monopoly on tea. In addition, right, Americans are going to get cheaper tea because they're going to cut out all the middlemen, and Americans will pay the tax because they'll get cheaper tea. Right? You know, so they'll pay the tax, they won't smuggle it in from the Netherlands anymore. And so everybody gains. Americans get cheaper tea, we save the British East India Company, Americans pay the tax, everybody wins, nobody loses, Americans reject that. They refuse to allow the tea to land, they intimidate the tea merchants or the tea middlemen that are gonna collect the tax. And remember, it comes to a head in Boston with the Boston Tea Party. Right? Now, what was the response of Britain to the Boston Tea Party? This is big. Britain's response. Now, this is the final. Go ahead, Benny.
Intolerable Acts.
Yes, the Intolerable Acts. Or the Coercive Acts. To punish. This is when Britain says, enough. We're sick of the colonies. They've taken it too far. They destroyed property. And so now we're going to punish them. We're going to shut the port of Boston down. We're going to limit their liberties. We're going to teach them a lesson. Right? Now, what was the colonial response to the Intolerable Acts? Yes?
First Continental Congress.
First Continental Congress, two things to associate with it. 1774, two things to associate with it. One, the Suffolk Resolutions, which denounce the Intolerable Acts and protect American, you know, rights, the Suffolk Resolutions, S-U-L-F-O-C-K, I think, Suffolk's, right, resolutions, right, that are really these resolutions that denounce Britain's actions. And the other is the rejection of the Galloway Plan. The Galloway Plan would have created twin parliaments, a parliament in America, a parliament in Britain, which would have had veto power over each other. Now, what you should know about the Galloway Plan is that it was rejected because the colonists believed that it gave Britain too much power over them. Right? Too much power over them. Now, okay. In the aftermath of the First Continental Congress, you'll be down in the office, Mr. Williams? Or in there? Oh, okay. Right. In the aftermath of the First Continental Congress, right, comes Concord and Lexington. Because the Congress said to prepare, Concord and Lexington are in April. It's pretty dramatic. But the significance of Concord and Lexington is it sets the stage for the Second Continental Congress. Second Continental Congress meets in the summer of 75. And the big debate in the Second Continental Congress, because war is a reality, New England is a reality, it's war is a reality. The big debate in the Second Continental Congress is whether or not to move to independence. There were moderates in Congress led by Dickinson that did not. There were radicals in Congress led by Sam Adams and John Adams, maybe to a lesser extent, Virginia delegates like Thomas Jefferson, who were pretty quiet, that wanted to revolt. But this is the big debate. Washington is appointed commander-in-chief, right, in the Second Continental Congress. The causes and necessities of taking up arms was published in the Second Continental Congress. And one of the things that the causes and necessities of taking up arms say was we're not fighting for independence. This is in the summer. This is in July of 1775. They're still not fighting for independence. Look, in June of 1775, you have Bunker Hill, the bloodiest battle of the war, right? You know, and they're still not fighting for independence. The Olive Branch Petition was Dickinson's idea, one last desperate attempt to reach out to the king and plead with him, right, to intervene and to stop all of this. The king rejects the Olive Branch Petition, declares the colonists in a state of rebellion, and moves to hire Hessians. And that's all in the fall of 1775. Those actions result in more and more Americans pushing towards independence. But really, what turns the tide? What did we say turned the tide toward independence?
Common sense.
Common sense. Who wrote that?
Thomas Paine.
So, did you read that in English?
No.
No. Thomas Paine wrote Common Sense in 1776, right? It is widely published. It makes common sense. It makes the argument for independence that resonates with the common people. In the aftermath, the tide of public opinion basically pushes the Continental Congress towards independence, right? Remember we said there were dozens of declarations of independence. Remember we read the Malden Letter in May 27th, 1776, the Malden Letter that pushed for independence. Dozens of declarations of independence prior to the actual Declaration of Independence. Finally, on June 6, 1776, Richard Henry Lee proposes the fateful resolution, these colonies are and ought to be independent. They delay debate on that resolution for 1 month, and in that 1 month period, they actually do two things. They establish a committee to draw up a Declaration of Independence, that is Jefferson, Franklin, and Adams, among others, and a committee to put together a system of central government, which is John Dickinson, who produces the Articles of Confederation. Now, we rarely talk about that because the Declaration of Independence that Jefferson and Adams and Franklin put together is more significant. You know, it's interesting. The Declaration of Independence is important. It's one of those documents, and we'll conclude with this. It's one of those documents that you should be familiar with. It's a quintessential American document. It in Jefferson's, you know, own telling of it, the initial draft he did without looking at anything. He just wrote down what everybody was thinking. You know, so why are we doing this? That's the question in the Declaration of Independence. Why are we doing this? Well, Jefferson is saying because all men are created equal, and they are endowed with certainly inalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. To secure these rights, governments are instituted in men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That's the big lines of the preamble of the Declaration of Independence. But the interesting thing about that is no one actually debated that, right? Everyone said, oh yeah, okay. They may have debated the grammar that Jefferson and the actual words that he used, but the content of the preamble was not debated by the Continental Congress hardly at all. Because what Jefferson said is this is how we all think, that you know the purpose of government is to defend the rights of the people, and Britain are violating that purpose of government, and it has to be stopped, and that we have the responsibility to replace this government with one that protects our rights. The big debate amongst Congress was all of the he's, the specific accusations of how Britain did violate their rights, right? Those were the specific debates. And remember, just you know, this declaration is a miraculous document that establishes for the United States the premise. It's what makes us Americans. I mean, you know, I told you before that what makes us Americans is not our language, it's not our culture, it's not our ethnicity, because we don't have an ethnicity, we don't have a race, we don't really even fully have a culture. That what we have is an idea, right? An idea. That's the American identity. The American identity is an idea that all men are created equal and that the power of government emanates from the consent of the governed, right? Now, that idea was incomplete from the very beginning. I mean, that's an important thing. Here is this miraculously spectacular document that states these extraordinarily liberal, enlightened ideas that people can govern themselves and they're all equal in the sense that they have these rights, right? But from the very beginning, there was the stain of slavery, right, that people recognized was inconsistent with the principles of the Declaration of Independence. And we know that Jefferson tried in the initial draft to blame slavery on the king. And that was omitted from the document at the request of South Carolina and Georgia, who would not accept any document that cast any kind of excursion on slavery. Right? So from the very beginning, despite this, the existence of slavery is a recognized inconsistency with what America attempts to do. Right? All right, that's enough. All right, that's enough. I could go on and on.
I must conclude. I must talk to Mr. Williams. All right, Mr. Williams.
Yo, Micah, get on camera.
Yeah, no, you do. You
put the plate in front of you.
Yeah. That's a routine.
No problem, cut this.
Nah. Don't. Hey, whoever is this, don't cut that.
No.
Say something funny so that people will watch it.
Hey, everybody at home.
What?
Wait, subscribe, follow for more.
Follow if you're thinking about 12. Come on, subscribe.
Yeah, subscribe.